Good afternoon. This is KPSU, Portland's college radio, at 98.1 FM on the PSU campus and streaming worldwide at kpsu.org. It's 1 o'clock, so that means it's time for The Rationalist. I'm The Rationalist, and my guest today is...
Bernie Dehler.
Awesome.
That's my voicemail says it.
Oh, okay. And this is the Hour of Atheism, sponsored by the Freethinkers of PSU. I start every show with a news segment. This week I am really prepared to put you on the spot, Bernie.
Oh, yay.
This is similar to what I've been told. NPR's Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me segment. So I'm going to tell you three stories. You have to guess which one is true, and the true one is the one that actually happened in the real world. So the first story. Conclusive evidence has been found of the existence of Atlantis. Second story, the Pope has resigned. And the third story, Congress has reaffirmed that the U.S. is not a Christian nation.
Yeah, pretty easy. The Pope.
Heard about that?
Yes. Yeah. Right after it happened, my wife was pretty excited about that. I don't know, it's just big news, I guess. But
I know, it's not something that personally affects me. I can't help feel, but like atheists could claim it if there was really a war between ideologies, you know, but at the same time, it's big news. It hasn't happened for like 600 years.
Yeah,
something like that.
Yeah, it doesn't really matter. Does anybody care? I don't know.
I don't know. About anybody. So. All right. So the next set of stories, you have to guess which one's true. First story: 36 people have died in the course of the Kumbh Mela celebration in India. Second story: scientists.
How many people?
36.
36 people. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Scientists have finally crossbred chocolate and oranges. And last story, Tom Cruise renounced Scientology.
Well, the crossbreeding of chocolate and oranges happened a long time ago. I remember eating these orange chocolate things. And
man,
I'm just
I thought
kidding.
I was being creative. Oh, you you played me.
No,
wow.
This, well, you can buy these. I got these for Christmas. They're like they're chocolate, something like an orange, and you take them apart
clearly,
in pieces.
Clearly not a fruit.
It looks like an orange. And it tastes, I think this orange is chocolate, but yeah, right. Obviously the India thing, but I thought that was, I'm surprised it's only 30. I thought it was, they died in a stampede.
Yeah, it was
36
that died, and there was like, on a train.
Well, I thought it was like a couple hundred that died, though, actually. So I'm surprised it's only
36. This might be a different incident, then, because I think it was bridge-related. There was a small walk bridge that people were going across.
Oh, maybe. The one I heard was there was some kind of pilgrimage, and they changed trains, and so there was a big rush, and then people got stampeded and everything.
Hmm. Yeah, I heard about their lost and found department. Like, people go missing, because it's like, they're expecting 100 million people in January, like from January and February, like this whole celebration.
Yeah.
It's apparently something that only happens every 12 years, and then this year it's the super big one that only happens every 144 years, so it's like 100 million people. And so far, the Lost and Found Department has reunited like 15,000 people. 15,000.
Yeah, it's pretty sad, too, because I think I saw a picture of somebody mourning their baby. I mean, they lost their kids, like, 8 years old, and
right.
It's like, you can imagine maybe their kids are just running around, maybe with friends or whatever, and it's like, where's your kid at? It's like, oh, geez, I hope he wasn't in that stampede, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
But the one I heard, they were pretty upset with the government because they only scheduled one train, and there could have been, you know, should have been more trains.
Really?
For all these
I didn't hear
people,
about that, but, so. Man. All right, last time I'm going to put you on the spot. One of these next three is true. PSU students have been chosen as the test market for the new Apple iWatch. A woman has died from drinking too much Coca-Cola. And the last story, a dinosaur fossil was found that refutes evolutionary theory.
Well, I just heard the Coca-Cola on the way over here.
Really?
So is that
so
brand new?
So you know all of these news, I think you're the first guest who has legitimately been like up to date on all the news.
Well, you know what? I actually listen to the news a lot. Like I have... my phone, I listen to podcasts a lot, and I like NPR. They have an hourly news summary, so I usually get that at least once a day. And then I sometimes listen to BBC News on there. It's kind of cool.
I do like BBC News. Yes.
And that's where I heard the Coke thing. I was listening on the way over here, and they were talking about that. This woman was drinking up to 10 liters.
I know, 10 liters a day.
And she had her teeth removed because of all the sugar, but she was like 30 years old.
I didn't know that she had her teeth removed, but...
Yeah.
I heard that that's twice as much caffeine as anybody's supposed to have and like 10 times as much sugar.
Yeah, right.
That's just crazy. So, to start things off, general, more atheist discussion. Why don't you tell us and everybody kind of about yourself, Bernie?
Well, I'm 50 years old, first of all. I look a lot younger. People probably think I'm about 35 when they see me.
Yeah.
I graduated in 1984 from Oregon Institute of Technology with a bachelor's degree in electronics engineering, and I became a born-again Christian after that, right out of college. Before that, I was raised a Roman Catholic. Then through the years, I was an evangelical born-again Christian and, you know, learning the faith, and especially apologetics, which is defending the faith, and evangelism, which is spreading the faith. So I come to kind of love those fields. So eventually, after, you know, since 1984, some 20 years, you know, more than 20 years, eventually, I wanted to even get in the ministry, so I part-time took online courses, and at a seminary, got a master's in ministry degree. I was actually looking at starting a church, and I got my degree in 2007. So then I started seeing how atheism is a big threat, mainly because of people like Dawkins who are raising it for the first time, it seemed like. I mean, in a very vocal way. It was like something, this is a new historical thing. So I was getting interested in that. So I actually started a group where Christians and atheists can come together and discuss things. And at the first year I was a Christian, and then during that summer I basically left the faith, you know, because I've seen that the atheists have superior arguments and things make sense from an atheistic worldview. So I became an atheist from an evangelical Christian. So
just
in
like
2000,
that.
Well, I mean, it took a long time. And I kind of study this stuff day and night, so that's what I do for a hobby. I don't watch football and stuff like other guys. So that was in 2009 I became an atheist, and ever since then I've been getting more involved, and I consider myself an activist. You know, I have a YouTube channel, I do meetups, I became a humanist minister, which is just a certification thing, really. I mean,
yeah.
So
pretty
anyway.
Cool. So, I mean, it seems like the answer to this question is fairly obvious, but on Dawkins' scale of 1 to 7, 1 being your 100% theist, there's no argument against God that can reasonably be made, or 7, it's 100% no existence of God. Where do you put yourself on that scale of atheism to theism?
Pretty much all the way atheist, because basically I think to do that topic justice, you should really, you know, recognize there's various gods. You know, when you say God, it's kind of an assumption. You're talking about Jesus or the, you know, Yahweh or the God of the Bible. But, you know, there's so many other gods. So when you start thinking about, you know, of course everybody doesn't believe in Zeus and all that stuff. So, and I think in the same way you can disqualify Zeus, you can disqualify the God of the Bible with no problem. So when you say, like, how certain are you there is no God, it's pretty certain, almost probably 100% for the God of the Bible. But then there's this... The philosopher's God, who's maybe a deist, or, you know, maybe somebody's a deist. Maybe there's some God out there who made things and walked away or died or something like that.
Yeah.
So, you know, I kind of figure, well, if there is that God, he doesn't care and he's not worth worshiping anyway. So, you know.
Right, and then there's, you know, the other, like, almost 3,000 gods of the other religions.
But when somebody says, like, well, you can't disprove the existence of a God, I disagree with that. Because I say, let's talk about which God. I mean, usually when they say you can't disprove God, I'll say, let's walk it through. Let's start with some of the easiest gods, you know, like Thor. And if you don't think you can disprove Thor or Zeus, let's even back up even more. Can you disprove Santa Claus? I mean, these people might, they get backed into a corner and they're like, no, I guess you can't even disprove Santa Claus. It's like, come on, you know. There's
right.
a guy who flies through the night and gives everybody presents on Christmas
Eve.
You
can't disprove that.
With Christmas
yeah.
magic, I mean, so.
Right. That's true. How has being an atheist changed your interaction with people that you meet?
People that I meet, like for the first time?
Yes, like in general. I mean, it might not change at all. You might still be the same person, or maybe there's some little thing that you do that you've noticed.
You know, I would say as a Christian, I probably had more of a love for people, because I mean, I was a real Christian that really believed that God loved us, Jesus loved us, I have a relationship with God, and I need to love other people like Jesus loves me, you know. So I think I was probably more loving that way, but you know,
so now I'm confused, because you're a humanist chaplain,
mm-hmm.
but you don't like people.
No, I didn't say I didn't like people. I said the difference is that I was probably more loving. Now I see people as they are. I mean, people are animals just like any other animals, and you know, we have our problems, and I don't see them as like special, and they're going to live forever, and they're going to be in heaven, and all that stuff. You know, there's some kind of special thing going on here. It's we're animals, you know. And that I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean in a factual way, we are animals, and that's not to say anything negative, you know.
So, yeah, no, I know what you're saying, and it's hard to argue that point because people do automatically assume that. Wait, they take animal to mean the same thing as savage or feral or you know, lower life form, and I don't take that viewpoint.
And it's just understanding our place in the universe. I mean, look at what we are a speck. We're not, it's not the universe revolving around us. You know, as a Christian might tend to think, like, you know, it's all about me and I'm gonna live forever and Jesus died for me, even if I was the only person. You know, sometimes they'll say something like, you know, even if I was the only person, Jesus would die for me. But it's like, no, the whole world doesn't revolve around us, you know. So so I, you know, so I guess my viewpoint is I'm more, I would say, sober, and you know, looking at the world in a more sober way, you know, more realistic way.
That's a really good way of putting it. A lot of my guests have been, I've kind of hit on that vein of it's just more realistic. Just what is reality, and anything beyond that is kind of, you can safely ignore it.
Yeah,
but sober is a really good way of putting it. It's a mental. Mental state.
So here's the thing that might have shocked you, though. I mean, you might have been expecting, well, now that I'm an atheist, everything is better. I love more, and I'm smarter, and all this stuff, you know. Well, of course, you know, I think I am smarter, but you know, like, look at Mother Teresa, for example. You know, Mother Teresa even said that she wasn't sure if God existed or not. So it's hard to say she did things out of love for God. And she even quoted a verse one time that, like Jesus gave the parable, the sheep and the goats. If you don't feed the hungry, then you're not feeding him. If you don't clothe the naked, that was him you didn't clothe. And so she does that all out of a sense of obligation, because that's what she thinks God expects of her. So I raised this to a question. I said, suppose there's a person here, and I put a gun to his head, and I say, you're going to do a lot of good works, or I'm going to kill you. So that person does a lot of good works because they don't want to get killed. But is that really good? I mean, and you can ask him after they get the gun removed, hey, you know, how's your life different? Well, I don't do all the works I did, but I don't feel like I have to either, you know?
Right.
So, you know, so I don't spend my time doing as much for others because I don't feel like I have to either so much, which, and I think that's a healthy thing. I'm having, you know, instead of being a doormat or being a victim or just doing things because you have to, as an atheist, you really start to learn how to live your own life and do what you want to do, you know, take charge of your own life. So
I've definitely thought about this as I've talked to atheists around Portland. There is that element of coercion when a Christian is doing something or tries to get you to come back to the faith or something. It's pretty obvious. And then once you give up whatever you used to believe in, it's suddenly not there. And having to look at yourself, why am I doing this?
Mm-hmm.
Is this just because it's good? What does that even mean? And that's, I think it starts a critical thinking process. It's just in and of itself a healthy thing.
Yeah, that's actually a really wonderful question, too. I mean, I would love to, like, for example, Richard Dawkins. As I was telling you before the show, I like Richard Dawkins. He's one of the guys I really like a lot. You know, and he's got some problems. I try to point out some problems, too. I'm not, you know, I don't worship him or anything.
Right.
But, you know, I think it'd be really interesting to have a real honest conversation with him and say, why do you do what you do? Because, you know, like, sometimes Christians will say, like, why do anything? Nothing matters in your worldview. Why don't you just kill yourself? Nothing matters. But it's like, yeah, but we could find meaning in our life. We can enjoy life. So, you know, why do you do it? It's not because we're trying to earn heaven or anything. You know, hopefully we're doing things because it gives us meaning in our life. It makes us feel good.
Yes.
You know, it's things we enjoy, basically.
And if that doesn't make some kind of intuitive sense, I mean, I don't know what else does. You know, enjoying your life. It's interesting that you brought up Richard Dawkins, because I believe that how we started that conversation was that people have fears that you're secretly a Christian masquerading as an atheist, I think it's due to your debate style. I'm sorry, but, you know.
No, it's fine. I mean, please elaborate if you can, okay. Because I can never understand some people.
Because I was at a debate of yours a couple weeks ago, and you're possibly the least aggressive atheist debater I've ever seen in my entire life, YouTube or not. And I have real respect for the way that you get up there and you talk about not so much refuting what the other party has to say, or playing into that kind of hand of atheism is just a reaction. You really present the atheist side as a positive thing of its own, you know, and that really speaks to people, because then you're not argumentative, you're not aggressive, you're not in the opposition's face, and people, or in Christians or other people of belief, see that they can respect it. They can sit, and they might start thinking, well, hold on a second, this is more than just being offensive towards belief. This is kind of its own entity. And at the same time, there's when you get attacked, like it happened a couple times in the debate, where if I was on stage, I would have done something completely different. I would have been much more aggressive, or just thrown it right back in his face or something. And you almost took the high road to the point where, hold on a second, is his intention to actually defend atheism? But it's kind of an interesting difference in style.
Okay, well, let me give you...
So I was always giving you the benefit of the doubt, but since you voiced that concern that other people have also voiced to you,
yeah.
Is there something you want to tell the atheist population, Bernie?
Well, I mean, to me, it's just totally, totally absurd to think that I'm an undercover Christian. I mean, one guy thought it was simply because I was in a debate in a church. If I'm in a church, I'm a Christian. It's like, give me a break. I mean, it's just, I mean, but anyway, let me talk about a couple things you said. Mm-hmm. One thing is, okay, first off, everybody has different impressions of what happened in the debate, so it's kind of interesting. I have my own impression, the pastor has a different one, and every audience member has their own impression, so it's kind of interesting. Now, really, I wasn't advocating for atheism. What I was trying to do is advocate for secular humanism, and so I was actually defining that. So, I mean, some people confuse those two, and like it says for the Council for Secular Humanism, it's going beyond atheism. Because atheism just says what you don't believe. It doesn't say what you do believe.
Right.
So I was making a positive case, you know, basically. The other thing is, why didn't I confront them when they say really wild things or wacky things? Well, there's a bunch of reasons. One is, maybe I wanted to, but I didn't have time. I felt like I didn't have time. I'm trying to be respectful. I don't want to interrupt them. And sometimes, I mean, when I watch debate, I look at it and say, like, wow, I could have said this or did that, too. I mean...
Well, I think debater does
that. Yeah, so anyway, we got to get you going in some debates and see what kind of feedback you get. Anyway, it's, you know, in fact, there's one excerpt I put on, you know, there's kind of a funny, I put this excerpt about Noah's Ark on there, you know, a sixth grader asks the pastor about Noah's Ark.
Right.
And in that, the sixth grader...
This is all on your YouTube channel, just so that people can... look it up if they
yeah,
want.
It's really popular on my YouTube
channel.
What is
your YouTube channel?
Yeah, it's called Sec Hummer. It's SECUHMMER for Secular Humanist. Hmm. And anyway, on this this excerpt, it's about 6 minutes long, but the sixth grader asked a question, the pastor responds, and then I responded, and then some other adult had a follow-on question on it. And when I listened to this, I mean, I was embarrassed, actually, listening to my own voice and everything. Do you ever do that? You listen
yes.
to your own videos and you go, oh my gosh, it's embarrassing.
Or your own podcast
yeah.
of a certain show.
Yeah, so I mean, yes. I think everybody struggles with that, and that's why people are like, no, I wouldn't go in front of an audience. I wouldn't do that. So I'm just kind of pushing myself there, too, and trying to learn, so.
Yeah, it sounds like fun, and at the same time, I think it's a lot of pressure.
You guys have a lot of potential opportunities here at PSU. I'd like to see you guys do some debates, man. I mean, people like you, I mean, oh boy, people like you, there's a bunch of people in the PSU group, it'd be so awesome to see you guys engage the Christian groups here.
Yes, and actually that's something that the Freethinkers have been looking into. We've just kind of been in a transition period between officers, the club officers that actually do take care of the administrative tasks. But that is one thing we're looking into, is getting in touch with we've been approached actually by the debate team and the philosophy club and all these different groups. And we will be doing that in the future once everything is settled. But
well, if you ever need anybody and you can't find anybody, I'll volunteer too. I like it. I'm
absolutely.
Always looking for professors to debate and stuff. I have a hard time finding them sometimes.
Yeah, well, it's the opposition has to be willing to engage in discussion. We had we actually have an atheist professor at PSU, and he's writing a book right now. That's the only reason he's not on my show. I emailed him. He's like, please contact me in a couple months when my book is near publication. Mm-hmm. But he was very involved with the Free Thinkers last year, and he's really cool. I've yet to actually meet the guy. We're just Facebook friends,
mm-hmm.
which is odd. But let's talk about secular humanism a little bit, because I know I describe myself as secular humanist, and it's for that reason that you said it really more describes what you do believe rather than just atheism, which is just what you don't believe. And I don't really, I've got to be honest, I'm fairly ignorant when it comes to secular humanism. I know the basic tenets. Do you know how it really started? What is the very historical basis of the philosophy?
Yeah, if you go to Wikipedia, I think a lot of the roots are, there's a Humanist Manifesto, I think it was around the 1900s, like 1910, 1920, 1930 or so. They have a Humanist Manifesto 1, and I think 2 and 3, I don't know how many they got, 4 or 5 now. But it started off kind of as religious people who were trying to have a godless religion alternative, and so there was some religious talk in it too, but it got more and more secular, and I think there's a whole bunch of humanists too, but the secular humanists are trying to get the title. So I mean, a lot of secular humanists just call themselves humanists instead of secular humanists, but there's all kinds of humanists usually out there too, like Christian humanists, etc. So anyway, when you say you don't know that much about secular humanism, that's par for the course. I mean, I think that most population doesn't know what it is. I mean, in fact, a lot of people even guess. Sometimes I talk to an atheist, are you a secular humanist? And so in their mind, they're thinking, what is a secular humanist? Okay, it must be secular, and it must be humanist. And you know what? I don't think humans are the greatest thing. I don't think it's all about humans. So no, I don't want to be a secular humanist. And it's like, that's not really what a secular humanist is. It's just a title for this belief system.
Right.
So like from my own research, like I did on my debate, I have my own definition of it. I try to make it really crisp and clear, because the secular humanist organizations, I think, you know, they don't really have a nice, crisp, clear,
and it comes in full one manifesto, right?
Well, I mean, they'll usually say all kinds of things like, oh, we're a naturalistic belief system, we don't believe in the supernatural, and then some of them can rattle off a whole bunch of things like we support democracy and equal rights and all kinds of stuff. So
I don't know if I particularly enjoy that, because it seems a little too political.
Do you want me to tell you my one sentence?
Yes.
Definition? Okay.
Yes.
And see, I memorize this, okay? Secular humanism is a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking and morality by using modern science and reason.
All right.
And every one of those words is really power-packed.
Polysyllabic, so. Multiple meaning, or... Well, single meanings, well, very concise.
It's very condensed, I would say. Like, you just add water to make it blow up, you know, expand on each one of those words.
Right, and when I think of humanism, I think of kind of a general greater good for humanity type attitude. It seems a little, I don't want to say Robin Hood, but I don't even want to say communist. But it seems very broad. Not very well defined, but at the same time, it's kind of an optimism towards what the human consciousness, in the Deepak Chopra sense, is capable of.
Well, it should be positive as far as there's actually a debate whether it's a replacement or an alternative to religion. There's a difference there, because like if it's an alternative, it's just another religious group. But if it's a replacement, it's like, you know, trash all religion and this is a replacement. You know, it's like philosophy instead of religion or something. So there's a debate inside the secular humanists over that. But, yeah, of course it's got to be positive. I mean, you know.
And I've looked at this as kind of a process. I've been looking at atheist processes and how people become atheists and what it is that happens. And the interesting thing for me is that when I became an atheist, just my critical thinking and wanting to understand how I think and how to be able to really root myself in these conclusions that I come to logically, I realized that I can analyze all these other things in my life. And one of the logical conclusions was a sort of skeptical optimism about the future. You know, if you're a believer, you kind of tend to think, well, I'm going to die and then I'll probably go to heaven, or everything's going to be fine anyways. If God really, you know, if things got too bad, God would probably stop in or drop in and fix things up or whatever. Or there's this kind of really optimistic somebody or technology will come in and step in and fix things. But then when I became an atheist, I realized, well, are these attitudes really justified?
Some atheists are looking for, I've heard atheists who really look for technology to save them. I mean, they haven't come to grasp their mortality. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, I hope there's some kind of invention where we can download our brains and live forever.
Yeah, I've heard that too. And as a Star Trek fan, that kind of thing creeps me out.
Yeah, I mean, technically, I think there's going to be a machine consciousness, but I think it's going to be different than a biology consciousness.
Well, yeah, actually, I was listening to this on a different podcast. It's talking about...
And not just different, but superior. So anyway, well,
if you're writing a contract, and rather than there being a person on the other side of the table who's going to sign it, there's a machine. Is there any circumstance where you would actually want to go through with that contract if the machine is the one signing it? If you write up a contract, buy a house.
Yeah.
Okay. And the other side of the table is not a person that you can hold liable, but a robot.
Yeah.
Are you more likely to go through and say, hey, I do want to go through with
you
this?
You know what? That kind of is already happening. I heard about this the other day. They have supercomputers that are trading stocks right now.
That's different.
Let me explain that. This one fund manager, they have billions of dollars, and these computers are making trades without the approval of the people. And so the people are saying, like, yeah, they basically are trusting these computers to make these trades. They are not approving the trades. The computers are making the trades.
It's based on an algorithm.
I know, but they're doing it automatically.
Right. So they... But when it comes down to it, if there's a bad trade, the fund manager is the one that's going to be responsible.
Probably. I mean,
but what if you go to a investment company and all they've got is supercomputers? There's not a person in charge.
Well, there might be a manager still. There's a fund manager.
Well, there's going to have
manager.
To be maintenance of the computers. Are you willing to trust a computer?
There's a president of the company too, right? He's ultimately responsible.
Right, but yeah. So, but the hypothetical scenario that I'm trying to set up is if there isn't a human, that ultimately there's some kind of liability that can fall on. Would you ever trust?
No, the liability does fall on the company, though, because like if there's a president at the top, the computer you make the deal with the computer, the president never sees it. The computer makes the decisions,
right?
And he manages it, right?
Right. Okay. And then what if the computer is the one that messes up? The president pays for it.
Sure, yeah, they pay for it. But
and
they,
then what if the president's another computer?
Someday it's going to be there. That's why I think it's going to happen.
I mean, I don't know. I don't.
You got to think about 1,000 years ahead, 10,000 years. Look at the trend of technology over 100 years. Then extrapolate out 1,000 years, 10,000 years, 1 million years. We might be on Earth as humans for 100 million years. Can you imagine the technology curve 100 million, a million years from now? Right. I mean, it's crazy.
And the thing that the guy in the podcast that I was listening to brought up was that it might not ever, that it's a different situation if you've got a computer on the other side of the table making a deal with you, because they don't have skin in the game.
Okay,
all these assets that you've built up over the course of your life, and if they're staked on a contract and the thing signing it is mechanical, there's a difference of what people are bringing to the table. That's why he said that he doesn't foresee technology as you know, there's a big moral dilemma there.
Okay, well, check this out. Let's say, for example, you know the computer like Watson, he can win at Jeopardy. You got the Google car, can drive itself. You got Deep Blue that can play chess, okay? So those are three apps you can roll into one. Let's say you get 100 more apps. So you get this computer that can think of all this stuff, okay? Now, somewhere at some time, you know, you have these companies like Intel and Microsoft. Somewhere at some time, some company says, we're going to be run by a computer. If they're run by a computer and they are more successful, another company will also say, we've got to use a computer too, because we can't compete here. They have a computer for a CEO and we can't. So at some point, CEOs are going to, you know, bubble up to computers, and we're going to want the president because we're going to have mayors who are computers. Sooner or later, humans are going to be subservient to computers. That's the way I see it, especially a million years from now.
All right. Well, this conversation took a little more of an Asimov turn than I was planning, but I do like me some Asimov. We're going to take a little break, listen to the KPSU promos, and as for stations everywhere. So, my guest today is Bernie Dehler. We just took a little break, if you weren't following or just tuned in. And we were actually talking about computers and morality last time. But I want to switch topics because as much as I do love talking science fiction, I know that we're probably outpacing our viewers in the nerdular way. But you were just telling me about a diversity group at your workplace.
Yeah, I work at a large company. We have locations all over the world, you know, and we have this way that we can have our blogs internally, and we have this homepage where everybody can see what people are blogging about and stuff. All this to say that, and we also have a diversity group there. I'm involved in the atheist group there, but people are going to find this amazing because it's a high-tech company making advanced computer chips. And I posted before an article about, you know, evolution. I was told I cannot talk about evolution because it might upset some people, you know, who are religious or whatever.
So, like, a manager came up to you, a supervisor?
Well, the human resources person.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, and then and I said, well, not even computer evolution? It's like, no, nothing about evolution. So just recently, I posted about, you know, Massimo Pigliucci, or I'm not sure how to say his last name.
Yeah.
He's speaking here for Darwin Day on the meaning of life, and so I posted that on there. And I have a meeting tomorrow now with HR because they're going to tell me how that's inappropriate. I mean, it's, you know, it was so gentle. It's like Portland State University is sponsoring this talk. You know, it's a biology department. So all this to say that even in a high-tech company, you might think, like, when you get out of college, you can really get out there and impact people. But it's like, actually, at the university here, you probably have the most freedom to... Because there's academic freedom here and everything. And when you get
plausible deniability.
Boy, when you get into a company, it's like, let's all get along here. You know, we have Muslims and Christians and everybody else. We don't want to offend anybody. So, anyway, I just thought that'd be interesting to share.
Well, I am in a conflict resolution class right now, and we do talk about it's kind of an avoidance is what we call it when people just don't want to talk about the conflicts that are present. So in your workplace, you said you can't even bring up like computer evolution.
Yeah, and then
does that include
a blog?
A blog, right? Does this does this include, like, is it Murphy's Law of computer chips doubling every exponential?
Oh, yeah.
Like every year?
They call it Moore's Law, yeah.
Moore's Law, that's what it is, yeah. Murphy's Law.
Yeah, Moore's Law. You know, that's not evolution.
That's not evolution.
That's Moore's Law.
Right, yeah. So that's a completely different, okay.
I mean, it's a different title or label. Yeah.
That's interesting. So, you just started this diversity group.
We've been around for, I think we're going on year three now, and it took a long time to get established because they were really nervous about it because we have other religious groups, and it's like,
other religious groups, but yeah. This one's the one right
Well, yeah,
trouble.
Because what are atheists going to do? Are they going to go out there and oppose all the religious groups? You know, it's like, might be troublemakers. This is what the general public might think about atheists. So, you know, we're building a reputation as we go.
Yeah.
So you probably have the same thing here in your group, too. You know, you got...
I do run
stereotypes.
Yeah, stereotypes of, oh, you just want to start a fight.
Yeah,
you know, that kind of stuff.
Right. Yeah, you're all about opposing religion, right? So.
Yeah. Well, the title is Freethinkers, the Atheist, Agnostic, and Science Advocacy Group. It's like once you say the advocacy part, you know, people have mixed impressions.
Well, you oppose Christians just like. Christians oppose each other too. I mean, the Mormons think the Catholics are wrong, and the Catholics think the Mormons are wrong. So, there's just one more to the group, you know. We'll say they're all wrong.
I saw Christopher Hitchens' quote this morning. It said that's probably one of the biggest things about religion is that they can't all be right. So the natural tendency is to assume that they're all wrong.
Yeah, at least one of them is wrong. Logically, at least one of them is wrong. Could be all wrong. Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Although that would be pretty impressive if just one was wrong.
Well, I mean, you know, some people make an argument too. Like, I mean, on the other side, from the Christian side, they say there's such a thing as a real dollar bill, and you could have a whole bunch of counterfeits. Just because you see a whole bunch of counterfeits doesn't mean there's not a real one.
Well, in the case of God, it's impressive that you're even seeing the counterfeits.
Well, the thing with religion is there's so many, I mean... Number one, there's conflicts against science. And number two, if they don't have any conflicts with science, there's so many philosophical inconsistencies within its own belief system. So,
I also saw another funny picture this morning that is unique in its approach, and that's that to make atheism more palpable for religious people, they rephrased it to be more religious, and it says atheism, the belief that Charles Darwin created the universe and sent his son Richard Dawkins to forgive our sins, makes perfect sense. Right? As long as there's some personification, right, then it might become more... It's clearly satire, though.
I don't think Darwin invented the universe, wasn't it?
I don't think Hawking
or...
Stephen Hawking.
Who's the other guy? There's somebody else who's getting... Krauss.
I don't know this...
Yeah, what's his name? I forget. It just blanked out. The universe... He wrote the book, The Universe... A Universe for Nothing. Lawrence Krauss, right.
Okay.
Yeah, and also Alex Valenkin, maybe.
I'm out of my depth here. Sounds Russian.
Yeah, but I don't... So that's probably who created the universe, but I don't know if the atheist sent anybody to forgive
sins. We definitely don't.
Maybe they sent somebody to teach people. I mean, the sin is ignorance, and so we need to teach them.
Right. I just thought that was funny. It's clearly far off base, but I think it's definitely satire.
You don't think it's real, huh?
No, Richard, I don't believe in Dawkins as our savior.
Okay. Well, he might be one of them, though. I mean, him and Harris, they pull a lot of the load there.
Yeah, that's funny.
I mean, they're two of my favorites.
Yeah, and I've...
But today's the worship day of Darwin Day.
Today is
this
Darwin's
is when
day.
People
Darwin's
are going around praising
it's Darwin's
Darwin.
Birthday,
and,
right?
Yeah,
it's his birthday.
Yeah.
There's free cake upstairs between Smith and Neuberger. No, where were we talking about?
Let me go on to the next topic.
Right.
I have a YouTube channel. I put videos on there. Okay. Remember, it's my YouTube channel name is Sec Hummer, SECHUMMER, short for Secular Humanist. Okay. So I have atheists, okay? I'm trying to be respectful. Because, you know, if you're a Christian, I'm an atheist, and I do a debate with you, and I put you on there, and everybody says, oh, that Christian was such a, you know, blankety blank blank blank,
right.
You're going to feel really bad seeing all that stuff, right? So, you know, plus there are four-letter words and all kinds of...
You want to be accommodating.
Yeah.
Yes, I understand that.
So, you know, and plus, if they're just personal attacks, they're just ad hominem attacks, they're not adding anything. So there's so many, you know... Atheists will put things on there. I just come to the point where now I just I ban them. They go on there and they'll say something like, you know, a bunch of F words and...
You ban an atheist? Yeah.
Yeah, I will if they just go on there and say, this guy's a F and blah, 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 blah. It's like that's their contribution. It's not even a logical comment. It's just venting. I just do it.
I got to be honest. I created a Facebook page and I used it to troll... sites that were specifically aimed at criticizing atheism. Now these are interesting because I wouldn't go out and troll Christian pages, but Christian pages that specifically put atheism in a completely unreasonable negative light. Like just one was titled, you know, atheists are dumb.
No, okay.
You know, things like that. And it's interesting because the people that do the ad hominem attacks that have nothing to contribute to this discussion, if you ignore them, on Facebook it's different than on YouTube. It's not as public. But if you ignore their comments or their posts, they just kind of fizzle out. Like they're a little evil genie that just like disappears. You don't give them the attention they're looking for. But on YouTube, that's a completely different situation because what you have is you have people coming to your site that are Christian, and then you have to kind of, you want that, you know.
Well, you know, I'd also like to say, let's, like Noah's Ark, okay? Let's have an intellectual discussion about it. You can say, like, how could you get all those animals on the ark? What about all the other boats? Did God go around poking holes in all the other boats? You know, those are funny, logical things to say. But when you just go up there and say, oh, this guy's a fuck... Sorry.
So we're talking about Noah's Ark.
Yeah, so somebody goes on there and just says, this guy's an effing, you know, whatever, and starts name calling. It doesn't contribute anything.
Who was going around poking holes in boats? You're talking about God? Because he only wants the ark to flow.
Right,
so you're saying he probably went around and poked holes in all the other boats.
Yeah, I mean, those are funny things to say. That's okay. It's like, these are problems with Noah's Ark story. What about everybody else that had boats? How come, how'd they get killed? I mean, they could go fish. They can get fresh water from the rain. I mean, how's that going to kill them? What, you know? I mean, those are valid questions. What would happen with the saltwater and the and the fresh water mixing, those are the kind of dialogues that I want to get. It's like, let's look at this and let's analyze this. But so many people just want to jump on there and just start name calling and venting, and it's like, it's no good. So I'm just not, now in the habit. At first it was hard to do it, but now I just do it. I just ban them. If they're just going to start spewing out a bunch of cuss words and stuff, I just ban them. And then, then they get all upset, like, oh, what kind of a narrow-minded atheist are you? You can't tolerate comments back, So anyway, it's interesting experience.
It seems like a pretty harsh thing to do with somebody who's online, but it's necessary. It's absolutely necessary. I think that one of the reasons it's a harsh thing to do is because of the cultural perception of, free speech. No matter what it is. But then again, if they're really truly just not being constructive or alienating people, subverting the whole purpose of your YouTube channel, they have every right to ban them. There's no justification for just going somewhere and just muddying the waters.
Yeah, I guess this is one thing I want to say too, is that I think all this social media, this is a brand new thing in history. And I mean, I could foresee more and more people leaving religion all the time. And it's because of things like this. When I was a Christian, it was hard to see debates because you'd actually, sometimes the ministries would sell them for $10 or whatever, and you had to buy a DVD or something. It's like, I'm not going to spend money. Now all of these, you're young enough, you're probably used to this, seeing all these things for free on YouTube. But this was not around,
Right.
When I was growing up. There are so many ideas out there.
I never thought about that, seeing as how young I am.
Well, I mean, and so like basically the company I work at, we're experimenting with this social media and we have our personal blogs. And so it's not, don't say anything about evolution because it might insult somebody. It's like, this is a brand new problem they never had to deal with 10 years ago.
Yeah.
So
And I saw a statistic recently that the number of people that accept evolution, I don't want to say believe because it doesn't matter if you believe, accept evolution in the United States is just like slightly more than most third world nations.
Yeah,
we are way behind on the education curve, and I think Iceland's at the top.
Yeah, you know what? I don't feel bad at all blaming professors for that.
Blaming professors for skepticism towards evolution?
No. The professors. Why aren't the professors out there debating and talking? Personally, I believe that a lot of professors don't want to debate because they don't want to look foolish against a creationist or something. They're worried about their own reputation and things. This kind of upsets me about professors. Why aren't professors, if they're really smart and they know their stuff, why don't they go out and help the community? Why don't they teach evolution to the, it's just so rare. I don't know.
Well, the weird thing that always surprises me is no matter how many times you clearly define and explain the concepts of evolution to somebody, they're always going to be looking for some kind of a hole. I've done this with relatives, and they have these strange ideas or notions of how things work. They're preconceived, and then once I start telling them about these, they suddenly start coming out.
Yeah.
Evolution can't work like that because of this, or they'll learn what evolution is, some little aspect of it, and then just say, oh, that's all there is to it. That's why it doesn't work. It's because that's how it is. And it's not a huge, complex concept. There is a lot to it. But once you understand, it becomes blindingly obvious.
Well, they don't really teach evolution in school, I guess, because it could be, because the kids are to come home and tell their mom and dad that they believe humans came from apes, or something, and they're going to say...
It's not a ridiculous proposition. I mean, just look at
the similarities. Yeah, but what happens is it's going to the kid disrupt homes. And this is an interesting, because I'm, teaching this course in critical thinking on Sunday's morning. Mm-hmm. They don't teach critical thinking either in high school or college either. It's kind of like the same thing. What's going to happen, if you teach a middle schooler critical thinking, what's going to happen when he comes home? What kind of havoc is that going to play,
That's an interesting political perspective on education I've never thought about. And I remember my teachers, especially in high school, really, in their syllabus, in their syllabi, they would always focus on developing critical thinking skills.
Oh yeah,
it's in there. The verbiage is in there.
Right.
But whether or not they're
But they don't really want to run through examples. Like here's examples of faulty thinking or anything like that.
Well, they get in trouble with the administration. It's mostly like I know several teachers that are very liberal, progressive, or conservative, and they just didn't want to say certain things because of the way that the principal would come down on them.
Well, imagine if you're a teacher in a class and you say, look, here's how you logically reason. Here's an example. Look how this example is fallacious. It could be something totally neutral. But there's going to be somebody in class who says, oh, yeah, teacher, what about, and they're going to ask something about God or whatever. So what's the teacher going to say? Oh, well, we don't talk about that. Or, you know, that's where the hot water can come in, you know?
Right. That's true. That's
and where do you draw the line?
It seems like politics has fouled up another profession.
But this thing about, like I said, about professors and evolution. Okay, so Dawkins recently came out with his book, The Greatest Show on Earth. It's all about demonstrating evolution and talking about creationists. Why is there a market for that? I mean, it's because it hasn't really been done before. I mean, it's like, why is it? I mean, it's good it's getting done, but it's like, this is just long overdue, I think. So.
Well, I guess I haven't been an atheist for very long, so I wouldn't know the pre-Dawkins show, Greatest Show on Earth.
Well, put it this way, he wouldn't do it if there wasn't a market for it.
True.
I mean, if people said, Dawkins, why are you coming out with a book like that? We have 30 books already.
You'd be the modern Nietzsche.
You know?
Yeah.
He's doing it because there's a market for it.
That's interesting.
And even in the book he says, you know, like you said, the vast majority of Americans, I think, deny evolution, right?
Well, I don't know if it's a majority, but it's more than other places.
I thought it was, like, really high. It's just surprising odds how many are creationist-minded.
Well, we do look extraordinarily ignorant to most of Europe.
I mean, I thought it was more than 50% or something like that.
I don't know the actual exact statistics.
And, you know, I think that's one thing that provoked him to write that book. And it's a pretty interesting book. Yeah.
Yeah.
I like it.
My brother was reading it, and I believe I talked about it on a previous show, probably with Ben Crockett. And it's really cool because it has pictures inside of it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, my brother was reading it, and he's like, hey, you got to look at this. I'm like, that's not a creature. Totally, you know, it looks very alien.
Well, you know, one thing that he says really powerfully in that book, which really impacts religions, and I don't know if he even knows the impact he has on that, but he has basically demonstrates that according to science, according to evolution, there's no such thing as an Adam and Eve. There is no first human. No first human. That's got to sink in. And he tries to do it with, like, at least two or three metaphors. Even the Catholic Church, a lot of people think the Catholic Church today, they don't have a problem accepting evolution. Well, they do, because they say that we all descended from one couple, one Adam and Eve. That's how we got original sin. And that's been disproven. People don't understand that. So the Catholic Church is by far the biggest Christian denomination, and they've been scientifically disproven in their theology.
Yeah, and they've accepted it.
No, they haven't.
They've accepted evolution, but they haven't really thought it through.
Yeah, I mean, the consequences... So I would say they haven't accepted it.
That's true.
But see, they got people that say, like, oh, well, the Catholic Church doesn't have a problem with it. Oh, really? Okay. So they pass that on, but it's not true. They do have a problem with it. So.
Yeah. When I was really, when I was reading The God Delusion, one of the concepts Dawkins talks about is the branching of species, you know. You don't just suddenly one day have a child that's a different species.
Exactly.
It's a complete continuum where the parent and the child are virtually identical.
Yeah.
But the great, 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 great grandchild is incompatible.
Yeah, I think Dawkins, I can't remember how many generations he goes back. I think it was like 198 million. He goes, let's take us, what would that person look like? And here it is, it's a picture of a fish, you know?
Yeah.
So.
I love that stuff.
Yeah.
It's an unfathomable amount of time. And that's the other thing, is most people think, oh yeah, so, you know, your great-grandparents were monkeys, is that what evolution means? No. It's a really big period of time.
Well, the monkeys are our cousins.
Yeah.
I mean, if we go all the way back to fish,
you know,
I think the dogs and cats are probably our cousons, too.
Yeah, I mean, it depends on how far back you go.
Because,
you know,
we're mammals, and they're mammals, and fish are not mammals. So I think if our, you know, great-great-greats are fish, that means mammals came from fish.
I think there's even a theory that, you know, we're eventually somehow related to trees. I mean,
yeah, I think that's still unknown.
It might be
debatable.
It's really out there, definitely debatable.
Yeah, but the reason for that, I think, is because the DNA code is so similar. I mean, the whole DNA structure, it's like, it's really hard to imagine that DNA arose and in such a similar way, you know, the whole DNA system arose more than once in plants and once in animals. So therefore, there's got to be a link at the root.
Probably, yeah.
So,
that's definitely true. So we have a couple minutes left. I wanted to talk about the event this evening, which is the Massimo Pigliucci lecture at 7 p.m. It's at Smith. It's not the ballroom, is it?
Wow, I can't remember.
Anyway, I will be there. It's going to be on the second floor for sure. And then next week, the Freethinkers are having Chris Dedman in town. He's another humanist chaplain, but he's at Harvard. He's considerably younger, no offense. He was an evangelical Christian, and then
he'll get older.
Chris Dedman wasn't an evangelical Christian, and then he pretty much came out of the closet and became an atheist. I don't want to say at the same time because I don't know for sure. And now he's really involved in the interfaith community, working on bridging gaps between religions and people of non-faith. And so he'll be giving a talk next week, the 19th at 6, posters all over campus. Is there any announcements that you want to make? Because you are part of a lot of meetup groups. When's your next debate, Bernie?
I don't have another debate scheduled. I just had one in January and February. At the Humanists of Greater Portland, I've been teaching a logical fallacies course, and I'm going to start another one on critical thinking, I think. So you can go to meetup.com. If you search for atheists, you'll see the Humanists of Greater Portland. And on Sunday morning, the humanists get together. They're a godless bunch of people who get together on Sunday morning instead of church. So
that's great fun. I go to the logical fallacy classes. Bernie's great. We have a good time. Lots of laughs.
Yeah, and then we have lunch afterwards, too, so get to know each other a little better, too.
That's right. I lied about the Massimo Pigliucci lecture. It's actually at the PSU Rec Center.
Yeah.
So it's not in Smith. But it is at 7, and it is today. Do you have any other announcements? I know you're really busy with all kinds of things.
That's it for about announcements.
Okay.
Yeah.
Check out the Freethinkers group. We are the Portland State Atheist Agnostic Science Advocacy Group. We meet every Wednesday and Thursday at 12:45 till 2. I should be at both of those meetings from now until I graduate. So